Good morning and welcome to the 22nd meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2023. I've received apologies from Tess White and Sue Webber is joining us as a substitute. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you. The second item on our agenda is the continuation of our scrutiny of frontline NHS boards. And for this morning's session, I welcome to the meeting Jim Miller, Chief Executive of NHS 24. Welcome, Mr. Miller, and we will move straight to questions. I wonder if you could tell me what efficiencies you envisage will provide the £2.9 million of savings required by the board.
Good morning and thank you for the opportunity to speak on behalf of the organisation. So the efficiencies set each year as a combination of our annual efficiency target and any balancing figures predominantly are based through a combination of what we call recurring and non-recurring items. So recurring by definition, those that we're able to take out of the system year in, year out, and non-recurring, those that give us movement within year, which may then be different from year to year. In terms of the our savings target, with the just under £3 million, we do have a plan which is a mixture of recurring and non-recurring. I would say the majority of that £3 million is on a non-recurring basis within year one as we continue to stabilise the organisation's position post-pandemic. Those include areas around procurement efficiencies and services that are contracted in, particularly our technology services. But a significant amount relates to our ongoing increase in workforce and therefore our ability to blend when we bring workforce on board, allowing us to have efficiencies in year. The board have signed off our annual accounts and are satisfied that we will make those efficiencies.
That's helpful. How will you monitor your invest to save proposals? You've touched on them a little bit there, and there was certainly some detail on that in what was submitted to the committee in advance of today's meeting. I think you described them as digital and workforce improvements. So how are you going to ensure that they deliver the expected savings? And over what time frame do you expect to see a return on that investment?
Yeah, thank you. So all of our, first of all, I think it's important that we have that balance of investment and continuing business as usual funding, as I would describe it. So the investment pot that we have set aside is designed to improve four or five areas. The first one is in terms of our workforce, probably most importantly, both in terms of our ability to recruit, to make sure that they're effectively trained and, of course, to make sure that they are retained, that they stay with the organisation for as long as possible. So there are investments, particularly in terms of what we call onboarding, so the way that people access opportunities within NHS 24, making it as easy as possible, frankly, for them to join us as an organisation. That's linked to digital, which I think is the second area and perhaps the area where there is most activity, given the shape of the organisation. So in relation to what we call the return on investment, then all of our proposals form a standard format. They're asked what the efficiencies will be, whether they're cash releasing, whether they're time releasing, or whether they're improvements in system stability, or whether they're a completely new system that would replace older systems and therefore improve access. So those types of checklist, if you like, are against all of the investment proposals and they're judged accordingly.
Okay, that's helpful. So in terms of that, how do, as an organisation, do you balance the rising costs and vacancies and plans for future expansion to meet the growing demand that we're anticipating there will be? There certainly has been a growing demand for NHS 24 services over recent years. So projecting into the future, seeing that demand increasing.
So we need to do things differently and more efficiently in parallel with each other. I think the core service is one that the public recognise and trust, and that's borne out by that demand and indeed that repeated and increasing demand. However, I think that does need to be blended with different ways of providing that service. So, for example, just at the end of last year, we introduced our first smartphone app. And we need to be careful, I believe, in introducing what I would say frontline digital technology, that that's not seen as replacing those services that people have become accustomed to and trust, but augment that as we see different changes in our demography and our age profile. Then we are seeing patients and users of our services that would prefer to access through a digital route rather than the telephony route. So we need to reflect that, but I believe it's an and, to make sure that people have choice and what way they wish to access the service.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring in Sandesh Kohani, who's got a supplementary on this theme.
Thank you, Convener. Can I just start by declaring my register of interest as a practicing NHS GP, but more specifically, I have and probably will again work in the GP out-of-hours service. Jim, thank you very much for coming, and I want to say thank you for the manner with which you've given us the data, because this is much better than a lot of other boards that have given us information. I think my question is around the 800,000 almost underspend, and in what you have said, it's because of vacancies that you have this underspend. So my question is, where has that really impacted? Which group has that underspend really impacted?
Thank you. So the organisation has grown significantly in the last 2 or 3 years. Probably the single biggest area, as you may well be aware, is our move from effectively, I would say, out-of-hours and weekend service to a truly 24/7 service. So that investment was around what was called the redesign of urgent care and the significant expansion of our mental health services through the Mental Health Hub. So both of those areas were given very challenging recruitment targets. And I think with all sectors, not least health, recruiting, particularly clinical recruitment, is a challenge. And therefore, a significant part of that underspend has been in relation to us not being able to recruit as quickly as we would have liked, and reference my previous point about why that's important for us to invest in terms of how we make that easier for people. There is a relatively direct correlation between our staff availability and access of service. I wouldn't deny that. But that's why, again, I think it's important that we look not just in terms of increasing our staffing availability, but increasing alternative channels such as digital to make sure that any shortfall in one can be offset.
Possibly pause you just there. On the question about which group, so we expand that a little bit to, was there particular areas where it was harder to recruit than others?
Certainly, I don't think it's any surprise that nursing posts remain difficult. We offer a different environment for nursing colleagues, and I think it's actually quite a positive environment, but a lot of our colleagues that are currently in nursing posts don't recognise that. So we're working hard to understand how we can make sure they understand what the NHS 24 experience is. I'm also aware that we don't want to get in a position where we are, in effect, robbing Peter to pay Paul, if I can use that expression, where we will be taking nurses from a territorial health board to join NHS 24, thus leaving them with the challenge. So what we are introducing now is what we call blended roles, where, and NHS Tayside is our first test board with this, where colleagues can work, for example, for 2 or 3 days with NHS Tayside and 2 or 3 days with NHS 24. That sounds relatively simple, but in the past it's been a little bit problematic because it involves two contracts and two employers and potentially two sets of shift patterns, etc. So again, we want to make that as easy as possible, and we do believe that there is some mileage in this where people can do an and working for more than one organisation as opposed to an either or. I think it also makes it much more interesting for them because they get to widen their experience without having to make a single choice.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm now coming on to Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Mr. Miller, for coming today. Information obtained via Freedom of Information request shows that there has been an extreme increase in dental calls to NHS 24 in recent years, with 25,509 calls in 2018-19 and 67,189 calls in 2022-2023 submission explains that the new urgent care model, which seeks to minimise onward referral, is in place for all but dental and some pharmacy calls. So how has NHS 24 adapted and managed that particular increase in demand regarding dental-related complaints or calls?
Thank you. Yes, all services have seen an increase in demand. We certainly, during the pandemic, we saw acute rises in demand in those services that were more difficult to access, so particularly primary care services, including dental. During that time, we were fortunate enough to be able to have a number of dental colleagues join us to provide an enhancement to our core, what we call the Scottish Emergency Dental Service. That included a digital remote consultation through smartphones, if people were able to and comfortable with that, and was a very, very useful service during that time. As public dentistry has opened back up, then we have reverted to what we'd call our normal model of the emergency dental service. It does link into other out-of-hours services and indeed into the redesign of urgent care, but predominantly it's where there's access to public dentistry. So we continue to invest in all of our services, including dental, balancing the demand to make sure that we offer that that amount of access that then doesn't create a challenge further down the line, if I can try and describe that a better way. So in some cases, we will receive calls that are because our patients are finding difficulty in accessing other parts of the service. However, there is an equal amount where actually what they're looking for is information and reassurance. So therefore, removing the demand from the service. And I think that's where, specifically to answer your point around demand, I think that's where we can do much more. As we increase the ability for us to enhance our digital resource, then it gives people an increased level of comfort, an increased level of information, so they can make decisions to manage their own care.
In light of the reported difficulties in people accessing dentistry services and increasing numbers of NHS dentists removing themselves from NHS provision, have you noticed a structural change since the pandemic in the access to dentistry? And in light of that, would you consider exploring further expansion of the urgent care pathway to help meet that increase in dental-related inquiries?
I can't say I've noticed a structural change in access to primary care services as a whole. Some recovered at a different pace, and some demand profiles were different based on public perception of availability. I wouldn't comment on whether that was real or perceived. However, it probably goes back to that original point. But I believe that NHS 24 is in a fantastic position. I would describe it to be upstream and downstream. And in this case, upstream is as early an involvement with the patient as possible, as early a point as possible, providing them information and advice, which then allows them to determine whether indeed they actually need the provision of dental service or whether it's something they can manage themselves at home.
Thanks very much.
Sanjish Kohani.
Thank you. I wanted to ask a few questions regarding performance as we look at data that you provided and also freedom of information information that we received. Over the winter period, a large number of patients had to abandon their calls to NHS 24 due to long wait times. And now, what analysis has been done on the effect of these long waiting times on patient welfare?
Thank you. And I think I would first of all make the point that I would wish that we had a system where everyone got the information they received without need to abandon. So every abandoned call for me is a learning opportunity. However, the analysis also shows that whilst we use the phrase abandon, for a proportion of those people, it's actually they have received the information they need within what we call the IVR, which is the automated voice message that already directs them. So whether or not they're in the right place, whether they can find information online, or indeed whether they should contact another one of the NHS services. So a proportion of those people that do not stay on the call have received information they need.
And what's that proportion?
I don't have that information to hand right now. And of course, it's not completely accurate because, frankly, we don't know to 100% where people have gone after they abandon. However, we do carry out fairly significant studies using third parties, asking people what happened next. So a proportion of those, and I'm happy to provide information to the committee on that at a later date, a proportion of those say that they have received the information that they needed. A proportion will say that they will contact their GP, and indeed also a significant proportion say they will call back at a later time. So we have to reflect that information in terms of how we provide access to the services. And one of the ways that we're doing that is to recognise two things. One is what we call repeat callers. So recognising whether someone has phoned back once, twice, and in some cases five or six times, and indeed they may have been answered more than once, and trying to understand their needs to make sure that they can get the information they need with one call as opposed to two or three calls. And the second point is where else they have gone in the system, if I can use that description, and how we can better reflect our services to make sure that they get that information at that point rather than creating a demand elsewhere in the service. So I will provide that information to the committee if requested. I would say it's clearly a sample in terms of that, but it's something we do on a regular basis.
And during your busy periods, what's the vacancy rate for GPs that are taking calls?
Sorry, I'm not quite sure I understand the question.
GP out of hours, where GPs take calls for NHS 24, what is the weight? What have you had in terms of vacancy percentages during the month of December, during the month of November, where things get really busy?
Vacancies within our GP colleagues. I'm sorry, I wouldn't have that information. So that would be within the individual GP practice.
No, sorry. So in the call centre, where GPs go to take phone calls for NHS 24.
Ah, sorry, misunderstanding. So yes, clearly we have what we regard as peak periods, and those tend to be out of hours, tend to be weekends, public holidays, etc. So the vacancy rate changes all of the time. I don't have a specific vacancy rate at any particular time, and of course it can be for a number of reasons. It can be a planned vacancy for annual leave or other services, or indeed be what we call unplanned leave, which is short-term sickness. So the information that's been provided to committee provides that overall, what we call the absence rate, or the both for short-term and long-term sickness absence. It does fluctuate from day to day, from shift to shift, and from week to week, so I wouldn't be able to give you a specific answer.
Okay. And with the length of time some people have waited, so I think the longest was over 2 hours that people were waiting on the phone to get help and advice. Do you feel that, what do you feel that you could have done differently, looking back at December of last year, that you will take forwards to this year's December to try to avoid the same thing from happening again?
Yeah, thank you. So last winter was an incredibly challenging time for all public services, including the NHS. And I apologise for every wait that's longer than that individual requires. I think it's important to say, though, that actually our average wait times are still significantly lower than those extremes, and I'm not suggesting otherwise. Those extremes are unfortunate. So there are a few things we do. The first and foremost is, and it's really important to recognise, is that we never cut a caller off. So there's no automated time where actually it's the system that so the person will wait, and they will be constantly reassured through updates to the IVR in terms of how long the likely wait times are. They will also continually suggest that they can be directed to our online resources to indicate whether that's something
people picked up. What was the learning that you've taken to...
So if I take those examples of what we did during the winter, then we can say, so how can we expand of those? So, for example, lots of our winter learning in terms of that information, in terms of their profiling over those peak periods, we reflected in our Easter performance. And our Easter performance over those 4 days was actually the best Easter performance in the organisation's history of 21 years. So some of those lessons taken in terms of our managing our demand and capacity, in terms of making sure that we provide the information and also the information that's digitally available, is useful for people. I would also reference back during that time, around about December, we were also experiencing very high call volumes related to people who were worried about strep A. which was a relatively short but intense period of demand, which almost came through a very short timescale, clearly there was lots of worried parents. So we had to reflect immediately in terms of the information for that particular condition on our online resources. So that's an important learning of understanding how quickly we can update and make topical the information that's available to patients.
Thank you. And my final question is, again, about the future. You referenced yourself how challenging and difficult the last winter period was. And my concern is the one coming might be even worse, because I think we had a bit of a mild winter, if we're being honest, when it comes to a lot of respiratory diseases. So are you confident that we will see improved performance times compared to, and performance data compared to last time? And what contingencies are you looking to put into place now, again, to mitigate any other issues that might arise?
Yes, yeah, so winter will always be the most challenging part of the year for NHS, and including NHS 24. And of course, that's exacerbated where other services are perhaps not readily available. So I think there's a few things that we have in place. The first one is our continued focus on recruitment and retention. So the more people we have available to provide the services, then that will help incredibly. I'm very pleased to say that we have recently overachieved one of our recruitment targets, where we were set a target of 200 and we were managed to achieve just over 250 in that period. But there are still vacancies to go, and as I mentioned earlier, we're looking at ways to improve those. So if we have an increased vacancy, that's point one. The second point is changes to the system itself. And one important availability is what we call the ability for people to understand where they are in the call. So there's the difference between someone having the telephone to their ear for 30 minutes or 45 minutes, whereas they could also be offered the chance to still keep their place within the queue, but get a call back when they're at the top of the queue. And that means that they're able to go about their day-to-day business, and it also means it's more convenient for them, and therefore we would hope that there's less chance that they will give up and go elsewhere. There is a challenge with that, though, and I think it's important to say one of the reasons that we're cautious about that is that sometimes that can create unintended consequences. For example, if when the caller is phoned back, they're not there. What do we do in that situation? How many times do we call back? And that's a resource that's then been tied up trying to contact the person rather than potentially answering the person who would be next in line. So these are subtle changes, but they can be really, really important. The app, I think, has proved tremendously interesting and useful for people. So we were careful to provide what we call a minimum viable product, which is basically a skeleton service to begin with, and then immediately get feedback from people in terms of what they would like from it. So we're on our third or fourth version now. There's a healthy and continue to increase user group of that app. And for example, we are now able to provide supplementary information. So example we're working on just now that will come out in the next few weeks is where the nearest defibrillator is, for example. So not just access to where is my nearest service, but where are my nearest complementary services. And I think the last thing in terms of preparation for winter is understanding how the technology can provide answers to people without them necessarily having to speak to a member of our staff. We've embarked upon what we call a digital transformation programme that will take us towards the end of 2025. We were already working on enhancement, particularly in our mental health services, to make sure that people can pre-populate their information as far as possible, having used us in the past. And then that means that there's a shorter wait time when they actually start to speak to someone. So all of these things will make incremental improvements. I hope that as a whole, then it provides us, along with our internal planning, that we're as in a resilient place as possible for a winter, whatever winter we may have.
Thank you.
Emma Harper.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. Thanks for coming today. You mentioned the IVR, is that the interactive voice response? So people whose English isn't their preferred language or their first language can phone. Do you monitor how many calls are made by people where English isn't their first language or Scots isn't their first language? So I'm reading here that there's ability to interpret Polish, Arabic, Mandarin, Spanish, Romanian, Sorani and Ukrainian. So do you monitor how many people make calls that English isn't their first language?
We do, yes. Unfortunately, I don't have that data immediately to hand. What I would say is we've seen a doubling of our translation service in the last 12 to 18 months through our partner that provides that service. Not just a doubling of demand, but actually a change in the profile of the demand. And you mentioned some of the languages there, which reflect changes that are happening within the country. So we have seen an increase. We do believe that it's a useful and important equality issue to make sure that people can access the service regardless of their choice of language.
Mm-hmm. And I think sometimes it's something that people might not be aware of, so they might go to the emergency department instead of phoning 111 because they just assume they won't be able to communicate. But if we make people more aware of the fact that there is this interpreting ability with 111, that's something that is only a good thing.
Yes, absolutely. And later on this month, we will launch the organisation's revised strategy. Now, part of that strategy will be that wider stakeholder engagement, including community engagement. It's something that's been more difficult for us to do in recent years, both in terms of pandemic and also ensuring that people understand that we are indeed a national service. So whether that's in central Belton, Scotland, or, of course, whether it's in remote and rural locations. So I do believe there's an opportunity for us to reflect our strategy, which sets out the ambition, but also gives an improved understanding of where NHS 24 sits as an integral part of the NHS in Scotland. So a series of community engagement and stakeholder engagement events are planned when we launch the strategy towards the end of this month.
OK, thanks.
Thanks. And if I can just ask a short question, you'd mentioned the redesign of urgent care. And the aim of that was to reduce self-presentation at A&E, I think, by between 15 and 20% by 2026. Is that on track?
So it's a complex picture in the sense that when, from an NHS 24 perspective, we will view the demand records and whether we've been able to direct those into what we call flow navigation centres, which are areas set within health boards that act as a alternative to self-presentation at A&E. From that perspective, I think we are absolutely on track. We would see currently between 11 and sometimes as high as 15%, but I would say around about 11% of a reduction in self-presentation in A&E. However, I would say if I was one of my colleagues from a territory board sitting here, they may not see that 11%. And because there'll be what we call displaced demand. Mm-hmm. So it may be that they are coming from other areas, it may be that they have tried to access services and can't, will still go to A&E. So there's not a single route. However, the redesign of urgent care, I think, has been very, very significant. And one thing I would suggest that almost as an interesting test of proof is that the redesign of urgent care coincidentally tied in with the restrictions during COVID. Clearly wasn't intended to do that, but that's where the timelines began, which is where NHS 24 really began to provide that 24/7 service. And we saw an immediate spike in our Monday to Friday 9-to-5 demand, simply because other services weren't available, mm-hmm. including the redesign of urgent care. We were all really interested as services opened back up whether that demand would drop. And the demand has not dropped at all. In fact, it's remained incredibly static, which we are making that line of logic that therefore that shows the redesign of urgent care is working for people, because whilst there are other services available, this is working for them, particularly in terms of that access through NHS 24 into flow navigation centres.
Thank you. I'm now going to move on to Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. What assessment has been made of the public awareness of mental health services available through NHS 24? Do patients, on the whole, know that they can access mental health support through NHS 24? And is the feedback you're getting that they're comfortable using it, or is there still evidence that a lot of people are going to their GP or other areas first?
Thank you. I believe the expanded suite of mental health services NHS 24 provides really gives an insight into the future of the organisation. So there are two primary mental health services provided, one called Breathing Space and one called the Mental Health Hub. Breathing Space has long been established and is well recognised and understood by local communities. Mental Health Hub is a more recent development, again coinciding with COVID. So I do think there's more to do in terms of making people aware of those services, and I'll reference my previous community engagement suggestion. However, the demand for those services is very significant, has grown very significantly, and indeed continues to grow, suggesting therefore that there is both an awareness and a value in those services. The services themselves offer different interactions, and there is a point where we are now looking to understand whether people are making a conscious decision around which service they use under that broad mental health service banner, and how we more accurately signpost the variable services within Breathing Space, a Mental Health Hub, and indeed our online health self-guides.
That's great, thank you. At the moment, people under 16 are advised to phone Childline. Is there a plan to expand the mental health provision for children and young people? And is there benefit in providing a dedicated mental health service like Breathing Space or the other interventions you've mentioned for children and young people in particular?
So, yes, we have seen, particularly in that, as you say, close to 16 age group, that there is a demand there. We need to be cautious in terms of how we develop services that are both safe and effective for younger people. So it's certainly something that we're looking at. The complementary services that are provided, so, for example, there's a significant amount of information digitally available on surviving suicidal thoughts, for example, and that has... We have seen a real demand for those digital or video-based personal stories, if you like, and how people have coped with their individual circumstances. The feedback we have received from the analysis of that is that those are picked up by younger demographics. So we're considering what that means for us in terms of development of those services. Again, it may not be that those are direct telephony services, mm-hmm. but perhaps more digital in terms of that information.
Is there a smaller proportion, do you believe, of children and young people, given the sort of digital literacy of children and young people? Is there perhaps a smaller volume than you might expect of children and young people phoning NHS 24 versus other interventions? And does that sort of lend itself to the variety of things that we need to provide?
Yes, so we look at both demographic in terms of age profile and indeed in terms of geographic profile, mm-hmm. Because we want to make sure that people are accessing our services wherever they are in Scotland, and of course whatever age they are. But you're absolutely right that the expectations mm-hmm. of different age groups are different. So, for example, we introduced called a bot. Don't ask me exactly what that means, but I think I understand. So we introduced a bot, which is an ability for people to exchange information rather than speaking to someone on the telephone. And that was fantastically successful. But when we did the analysis, actually there was more girls than boys used it. And I say girls and boys because they were a younger demographic as well. So the most used demographic of that bot was younger females. So again, that's real interesting data in terms of how people choose to access mm-hmm. the service. I think we all recognise that actually those younger age groups are much more likely to engage completely digitally mm-hmm. than they are even to pick up the telephone, which they may feel is old-fashioned.
Does that feed into some of the ongoing service development of NHS 24, is looking at what does suit the population now and what has to continue to develop, particularly in the mental health space over the coming years?
Absolutely. And again, if I reference the NHS 24 online app, that's a way where people can access the service through a digital means and then directly into a traditional telephony service, but you've got that digital interaction. I still think that it's important that we keep more than one, that those multiple access. So we, part of our 2025 programme is what we describe as an omni-channel, which again is a technology phrase, which simply means that instead of there being, there's no wrong door, I think is the way to describe accessing the service, whichever way that you choose to access the service.
That's great. Thanks, Convener.
I'll move to Carol Malkin.
Thank you, Convener. Morning. I've got quite a specific question, really, about the route through the mental health hub. Just some constituents have raised with us in terms of if you phone into the NHS 24 and you're already known to mental health services and you're looking to get directed on, is that quite a smooth flow through, or do you have to go through quite a number of the assessments before being linked into your already known service?
So I think with all of the access points into NHS 24, it's important that we establish some core information. So that may, the skill of our call handlers, I think, is extraordinary, because very often when people phone, they can be distressed, they can be confused, and actually they just want help. So they're unlikely to give you information from A to Z in that order. The skill of the call handler is to make sure that they bring them back to that point, so that we understand that we've established identity, that we've established that they're safe, and then we establish their reason for calling. So I don't believe that those are unnecessary steps, and I think it's important that we get through those points as quickly as effectively as possible. That also allows, I think, a trust bond between the patient and the call handler at that point, and then that discussion takes place. So wherever they access the service, then those onward routes, I believe, are relatively smooth in terms of that information. However, I also think there's more that we can do. And again, very recently, we have now introduced our ability to an area that we hadn't previously been able to access, provide patient information to, and that's community pharmacy. So again, a very important part of our community-based services. So we can now provide information to community pharmacy and vice versa, so that smooths that path. We have this ambition where we say we want people to be able to tell their story once. Now, I don't think we're there yet. I genuinely don't. However, I think it's something that's really important to us, and I think it is something that we're improving.
That's lovely. Thanks very much.
Yes, Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thanks for being here this morning. Couple of really quite short questions. I'm wondering about distress brief intervention. Do you monitor if you're getting repeat calls through, for example, in that area? And my second question is about children and young people as well. So if there's a child, a young person, or their parent or carer that calls you and they're in a great deal of distress, are they actually told to hang up and call another number? Thanks.
So in answer to the first point on a DBI or distress brief intervention, so we NHS 24 represents over a third of all referrals into the DBI service. We are the single largest referral point. And it's been a really useful. So DBI level one is contained within NHS 24, that compassionate approach. And the DBI level two, as you, I'm sure you'll be aware, are provided by a range of predominantly third sector providers. So almost by the nature of that service, we do see repeat callers, both into DBI, into our mental health hub, and indeed, perhaps more so, into our breathing space service. Now, that's for me, is actually one of the beauties of that service, that actually it doesn't matter whether you need us once or whether you need us five times, that we're still there to help. Where I think we have an opportunity is that whether there are, therefore, alternative methods of help available to people who have perhaps contacted those services on a regular basis. The DBI service is very good at providing onward referrals. So, for example, it may not be a direct health issue. It could be a social issue, a family issue, a justice issue that they need help with. So I think DBI is a fabulous service. Apologies, would you mind repeating the second question, the second part of the question?
So it was around not providing direct support to children and young people. And my question was, if there is a call that comes through them from a child, from a young person, and they're not always bordering the 16 age group, they can be quite a lot younger now as well, or their parent or carer, and that child or young person is in real distress, would they be told to hang up and call another number, or how would that be handled?
No. Clearly, it's situation-dependent, depending on which service the nature of that distress. But if we do ask if there is someone there that would be able to provide additional information or help if they're significantly distressed, but we wouldn't tell them to hang up.
So would the next step in that process be, for example, asking them to attend A&E if the situation was quite serious, or...?
Well, if it was serious enough to attend A&E or indeed warrant them to call 999, then that would be the referral we would provide. We have very small, so our 999 referrals are very static. They're about 5.5% of calls that come into NHS 24. The suggestion is that they warrant a 999 call, and then as we move down a queue into A&E, then those percentages change. But regardless of the age of the individual that contacts us, then the core triage system, that patient safety system that sits underneath it, remains absolutely stable.
Thank you.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. Data has shown that the number of mental health-related calls to NHS 24 increased from 20,434 calls in 2019 to 139,008 calls in 2022, which, by my calculations, is a 580% increase, extraordinary number. Has that overwhelmed you? It seems an incredible figure that isn't necessarily proportionate to the extra resources that you've been able to put into this service. How have you been able to adapt to that significant increase in demand?
The demand absolutely has, as you say, the shape of the curve has been really quite quite marked. The introduction of the Mental Health Hub has been as round about 2019 as well. So that was that immediate response, also available 24/7. Breathing space currently is not available 24/7. It's predominantly still those out of hours periods. So first of all, we immediately increased our capacity by genuinely being available 24/7 for mental health services. We also created a new role for NHS Scotland, and it's what we call the psychiatric wellbeing practitioner. Sorry, psychological wellbeing practitioner, apologies. And that we have, first of all, that's a post that people find very attractive if they're looking to further their clinical career. So that's been a post that we've been quite fortunate in being able to fill quickly. However, it's also a post that gives them such rich learning experience that we have found that they tend to move on within the NHS pretty quickly. So there's a sort of a positive and a negative, if you like, there in that challenge. The investment that we've provided in terms of mental health services have allowed us to get to almost our target figures within those services, and we have seen a commensurate increase in our ability to pick up those calls. But there's no denying that the demand is and continues to be very high.
It seems clear to me that dental and mental health areas are significant parts of the overall healthcare system under serious pressure. How sustainable is it for NHS 24 to be that certain first point of contact, but then how effective can it be to refer on when there isn't the capacity in other services where you are signposting it? Do you feel this is sustainable as an approach of it as part of the overall model?
I think we need to change to continue to be sustainable. I believe organisations like NHS 24 are exactly what will provide the sustainability of our health services moving forward, where there's alternative methods of access, where there's information and where there's those connections. And I firmly believe that whilst we have a focus on our we talked about redesign of urgent care and accident and emergency, so that's sort of acute setting. If the further we're able to move upstream, as I mentioned earlier, into that primary care, indeed into that preventative space, so for example, providing information on healthy living, on dietary requirements, and actually removing the need potentially for services, there's also that downstream activity. Now, this is an area where we are I think, in the foothills of the potential of NHS 24. But areas such as providing people reassurance, information and advice, for example, when they are discharged from hospital, when they're immediately discharged and perhaps find themselves having an ongoing condition to manage, that can be very stressful. And therefore, there's something about us understanding how we can work with our community-based services and augment that to provide people becoming nervous and then potentially contacting their GP or indeed requiring readmission into hospital. Now, I would emphasise that those upstream and downstream services, I think they're fledgling just now, but I think in specific response in relation to mental health and digital, is the view of looking upstream and downstream that will give us that sustainability.
Just wanted to also put this in context of severe budgetary pressures faced by healthcare, not just based on demand, but also the fact that, for example, the mental health budget effectively has been frozen in cash terms this year, with the cut to mental health being restored to bring it back into level as it was last year. What impact has that had on your services? Has it meant that you've been able to offer an alternative interface, or is it actually something that you're feeling the pressure on as well?
So, there's no part of the health service that doesn't have to make sure that we keep a very, very close eye on our budget, both in terms of making sure that we have a balanced budget, but also that we have an effective spend of that budget. And it's that last point, I think, that's important across all of our services. So we need to make sure that we look at how the services have been developed, whether they will continue to be fit for purpose in the way that they are provided, and also recognising and getting feedback from the users of those services, actually what works for them, and whether they would be willing, or indeed whether they would see it as an additional value for those services to be provided differently, for example, via digital or remote resource, rather than changing the service and then asking people to expect to react to that, is making sure that actually you take the voice of the patient first and build services around that.
The only last thing I was going to ask was the interface between the police service and NHS 24. We do know there's been an increased number of call-outs for police attending mental health-related incidents in the community. Do you have a referral from NHS 24 to police, or do you see that people are actually contacting NHS 24 instead of contacting the police, and that's a more appropriate presentation? Is that something you're able to provide any analysis of?
Yeah, so if I take the example of three partners in that, so Scottish Ambulance Service, NHS 24 and Police Scotland, we've done significant work there to make sure that we work together in that space. And sometimes it's we have recently ran a programme where, instead of the police attending, which can actually sometimes inflame a situation, then the police will get the call out, but they will refer the individual to the mental health hub. And that is a judgment based on the particular circumstances at the time, and sometimes it's on site, wherever that individual is. So rather than there being a police response, the police respond, but then provide that information into mental health hub. And likewise, between ourselves and Scottish Ambulance Services with Police Scotland, we're working at how we can operate those three areas. So rather than it being an escalation to a requirement for an ambulance, or indeed the requirement for the police, where can NHS 24 pick up that demand?
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We're getting a bit tight for time, so if I can ask for concise questions and concise answers, please, and I'll move to Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. We've talked a lot about distress, brief intervention and breathing space in the mental health hub, and we know that a lot of work has been done to reduce stigma around mental health, so people then feel it's okay to reach out. So how has COVID impacted the issues around directing people to breathing space, DBI and mental health hub?
I would never say that there was a positive from COVID. That would be completely the wrong thing to say. However, what it has done, I think, is heightened the awareness of the public of Scotland to the services that NHS 24 can provide. That along with the additional investment to make sure that it is truly 24/7, then I think the public have responded incredibly well. So there is a positive aspect to that we have now seen increased demand, whether it's 9 to 5 Monday to Friday, or whether it's those traditional times where NHS 24 would pick up at weekends and out of hours.
And just a final wee quick question. does NHS 24 use the ALICE system, which is the local information system, directing folk to third sector organisations to help support, for instance, with mental health issues? Is that something that you would see as part of the upstream and downstream plan, is using ALICE or directing to other local third sector services using whatever app is available locally?
Yes, so the Scottish Service Directory, which currently provides information on primary care services, so GPs, pharmacists, etc., is embedded within both NHS Inform and indeed the app. And that allows people to then, wherever they are, so they may be visiting another part of Scotland they're not familiar with, so they can pick up that geographically specific data. Very quickly, I think NHS Inform is also, I believe, could be an enhanced national asset. I think it needs some work, and we have currently agreed with our colleagues at Scottish Government that we will transform both the content and the way that people engage with NHS Inform, and that would pick up exactly, I think, the point that you're making in terms of access to those direct and supplementary and complementary services within health.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. And we'll move on to our final theme, Evelyn Tweet.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Jim. You had mentioned earlier about blended roles, how you were looking at recruitment and retention. Can you tell us some more about various strategies that NHS 24 is using?
Yeah. Thank you. So I think NHS 24 provides a very useful, I would say, alternative to that traditional idea of Monday to Friday, 9 to 5 employment. Vast majority of our staff operate on a part-time basis and therefore and operate at times which may suit their requirements at that period in time, whether that's that they are students, whether it's maybe people with young families or other caring responsibilities, and they will fit the job around their work, which is fabulous. It does mean that we see, I think, a higher attrition rate than the traditional, if I can put it that way. But I think there's something in this to learn, to take the learning from, that actually, therefore, we would expect a higher turnover for those posts as people either move on or go back to university or whatever. So how can we make sure that we can bring people in seamlessly? How can we make sure that the training is both effective and modern? So things like gamification of our training, so that people start to learn before they start. Mm-hmm. So there are also areas about... The perhaps the most common question I'm asked is home working versus being based in one of our geographic centres. And that is something that we're looking at. We recognise that the workforce requirement has changed. However, it's really important for me and my colleagues, certainly for myself as accountable officer, that whatever service we provide, first of all, is safe and effective for the patient. Just now, we have now got the ability for our clinical supervisors to be completely remote. So whether they may be in the centre, they may be at another centre, or indeed they may be within a hospital location or indeed within their home. And that's a very recent intervention, again, to perhaps make it easier for people. If I talked about blended roles, so does that mean, for example, someone that perhaps works in NHS Dumfries and Galloway could then provide 1 or 2 days a week for NHS 24, knowing that they perhaps don't have to travel to the centre? These are sort of questions that we're asking ourselves. We have found, actually, that the response to that remote clinical supervision is that the vast majority of our nursing colleagues still like that face-to-face contact. Mm-hmm. And whilst it's an option for them, we find that actually they tend to come into the centre. However, in conscious of time, I think, again, these are those incremental improvements. So whether it may be one shift or one instance a month, where it would be more difficult for that person to attend work, if they're able to attend work remotely, then I would rather they did that rather than not attend at all.
And for my second question, I noticed from your data that staff attendance is getting better over the months. So in December 22, it was 89.5, and in May 23, it was 92.5 for staff attendance. What are you doing about staff wellbeing?
So first of all, I'm really pleased to see that increase in staff availability, because frankly, the more staff we have, then actually the less stress it is for them covering potential absences elsewhere within the team. So I think that's the first point. Wellbeing is critical to our staff within NHS. I think we also need to recognise that many of our staff work in areas where it's 2 o'clock in the morning, 3 o'clock in the morning, it's Saturdays, it's Sundays. So it's a very different working experience for those staff than many people who work a traditional 9 to 5. So resource availability in terms of those supportive resources, for example, we use, and we're a significant user of the Thrive app, which is a mental health related self-help and diagnostic app. We've had a very good uptake on that. We have our mental health charter that all of our colleagues are aware of. We also make sure that the digital resources, so the access to, so if I need help with my, if I need help with my wage slip, then if it's 2 o'clock in the afternoon, I can make the call potentially to payroll. If it's 2 o'clock in the morning, I can't. So how do we make sure that those services are equally available for people who work out of hours and in hours? Because we are still effectively an out of hours service in terms of the shape of our demand, albeit that we are now 24/7.
Okay, thank you. And Sue Weber.
Thank you. Yes, thank you, Convener. It's just a brief supplementary, Mr. Miller, just about the retention element. Again, you've mentioned some of the things you're offering in terms of flexible working. But you also did speak of your higher attrition rate, mostly because of perhaps some of the people that are coming on. What else are you doing to try and tackle that retention element, try and keep as many of the staff in post as long as possible?
So a number of things. We've introduced what we call stay conversations. We find quite often when you join an organisation, there's a period where you're going through training or induction, and then you're kind of left to it sometimes. So we want to make sure that the individuals don't feel that left to it. So we have introduced those stay conversations at a 30-day, a 60-day, a 6-month, and indeed a 12-month period, just to make sure there's a specific check-in point in terms of how it's working for them. And with those, again, that's a relatively recent intervention, but I think people find that, both from a manager's perspective and the individual's perspective, it's a good touch point for them to make sure that they've got that protected time. Learning from exit interviews is also really important for us. Now, exit interviews within the NHS are voluntary, but we're making it as easy for people as possible to provide that exit interview, and we take that learning from it. Mm-hmm. We also have a significant amount of staff who move within the NHS. So there's, again, back to that my earlier question on blended roles, how can we share that wider resource across NHS Scotland? And are there opportunities for those individuals potentially to come back to us in NHS 24 after they've gained experience elsewhere? So rather than concentrating on the reason for leaving, I think we're trying to concentrate on the reasons why people would want to stay, mm-hmm. making sure that the workplace, I think we have a very high quality workplace offering for people. They're bright, they're airy, they're safe, they're secure, they're easy to access. We provide lots of on-site welfare and wellbeing opportunities. We also provide, obviously, that corporate access through to our HR and workforce services, and indeed those opportunities for training and development.
Is there anything over? Everyone always wants more, but in terms of the package that the staff get, it's not just about pay and pensions, is it? Is there anything else that they get that encourage them to stay with NHS 24, or is that all sort of predetermined on an NHS national level? I'm meaning health facilities, health facilities, gym facilities, all those sorts of things that might... I'm not sure, I'm maybe overreaching a little bit.
It becomes a little bit more difficult in terms of making sure that we operate within that NHS Scotland parameter. However, we are... In fact, we're actually in open conversation just now with our colleagues over in the Clyde Bank around accessing some council gym facilities. So I hate the phrase, every little helps, but I think it does in terms of that space. The one thing very quickly I would say is that I think it's really important, particularly for our call handlers, when they join NHS 24, they understand the difference between an NHS 24 contact centre environment and perhaps where they've either been or where they perceive that to be. It's a very challenging role, And I, again, I would commend the skill, absolute skill of our call handlers is mind-blowing. But we do have people that find that very difficult within 2 or 3 weeks, and they'll say this is simply too difficult. So that's not good for them and it's not good for us. So we are developing situations where they can almost get an experience. What is the NHS 24 experience? So we're trying to work with schools and colleges for people to come along, okay, understand what that would be, and then they can decide whether it would be for them rather than making that choice and finding that it's not.
That's very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I need to declare an interest as an RMN with current NMC registration. But having visited the NHS 24 Mental Health Hub and seen the figures that you've presented to us in terms of people accessing the service and in terms of the improvements in accessing telephone, I suppose I've just got one very brief question about breathing space. And if there are plans to expand access to breathing space out with the core hours it has just now.
Okay, thank you. So, there are no specific plans to expand breathing space per se. What we are looking at this year is how we take that overall totality of our mental health services and treat that as a suite of services and make sure that people are accessing services in an informed manner, rather than, you know, someone perhaps has used breathing space in the past and will use it again because they've got the number, as opposed to actually my requirement right now is probably better suited to the mental health hub. Mm-hmm. I think that's something we need to do more of, and that would effectively increase the capacity across the space.
Thank you very much, Mr Miller, for coming along to the committee today, and we'll suspend briefly. We'll continue with our scrutiny of frontline NHS boards, and I welcome to the committee Pauline Howie, Chief Executive of the Scottish Ambulance Service, and we're going to move straight to questions, Ms Howie. So I wonder if it's possible to detail exactly how the board plans to achieve the 3% efficiency savings needed to achieve financial balance over the next three financial years.
Yes, we have a comprehensive best value programme in place that each of our executive member teams leads an aspect of, and that reports directly into our 2030 strategy group, our audit committee, and into our board, who consider the financial position of the organisation at every single board meeting. The plan looks across the whole area of our activities to try to identify those areas, for example, that we might have introduced in response to COVID, whether we can respond in a different way to some of those cost pressures. It also looks to see how we can recover overtime costs, which have been significantly higher during COVID, for example, because of wider issues across the entire health and social care system. Our ambulance staff, you'll be aware, spend longer at the front door of hospitals, which adds to the time to complete each patient cycle and frequently results in staff being held back at the end of their shifts too, which results in more overtime too. So we're working very closely with other boards to try to identify ways in which we can more safely and effectively manage those patients at the front door and ensure that our staff get finished their shifts on time too and reduce overtime costs. We're also looking at electric vehicles, and we're about to prototype the first UK electric ambulance here in Scotland. We're working with vehicle manufacturers to try to identify more carbon efficient ways of running our vehicle fleet. We're looking at LED lighting across our entire estate. We're looking at sharing services where that's entirely possible to do so. So we have shared payroll services across the NHS. We're working with the other emergency services if there's anything we can do, for example, around emergency driver training. We work with the other UK ambulance services around joint procurement activities to try to identify savings where we can do something across the entire UK.
That's really helpful and kind of sort of leads on into what the other areas that I was looking to explore, which was really to look at what extent can the savings be expected to be sustainable in the longer term. So that I am assuming from what you've said there that a lot of the sort of joint working, cross-sector working with other parts of the NHS is part of that sustainability plan.
Absolutely. All those areas that we're looking for, we're trying to get into a recurring, sustainable financial position. You'll see from our submission that we don't think that'll be entirely possible this year. However, that is the plan over the 3 years of the financial planning cycle to get into a recurring, financial, sustainable position.
Thank you. And Sandesh Gohani has a supplementary question.
Thank you. Just to declare my interest as a practising NHS GP, but I was really interested and I wanted you to expand a little bit further. Electric ambulance, to me that's really exciting. Could you tell us a little bit more about that and what's its range? And
so it's very much under development at the moment. We expect it to be introduced into our fleet by the end of the year. We haven't publicised that with the manufacturer yet, so there's very little that I can say because I know that the manufacturer are desperate to do a proper launch with us. But they are content, not to be named today, but for me to mention that we are the first ambulance service in the UK to actually bring an electric ambulance into service by the end of this year. So obviously we need the range in Scotland to be significant because our ambulance fleet covers significant number of miles, as you can imagine, not just in the rural areas, but in our more urban areas too. Typically, we might cover 10 patients a day and the fleet can stop and start in several areas, even across cities, be deployed across the whole of Glasgow, for example, the whole of Edinburgh. So our fleet does cover significant miles, and that's one of the areas that we've been working with manufacturers on to get a fleet that's got sufficient range to enable us to be confident that it can indeed satisfy our requirements.
Thank you.
I'm going to move now to Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for joining us today. I have a question regarding the codes that are mentioned in the submission that you've made. Red and purple are assigned to emergency calls, as indicated, but despite those emergency markers, I understand that these patients can still wait hours to get a response. Indeed, I'm familiar with one constituency case where a red call patient was waiting 6 hours and 50 minutes for a response. Paramedics and your team are trying exceptionally hard on impossible circumstances. What can the Scottish Government do to support the service and improve response times to these critical calls, and how can the system improve that flow of returns?
So I'm pleased to advise the committee this morning that our response times across all categories of call have been improving, and that's principally to do with significant investment over the last 3 years into what we call our Accident and Emergency Demand and Capacity Reform Programme. So this has seen the introduction of an additional 458 ambulance posts into frontline services, an additional 52 ambulances and 10 new ambulance locations from which we deploy those ambulances. And that is based on historical demand updated as we've went over the last few years. The last cohort of those additional staff are currently in training. They'll finish by the end of this month, 80 ambulance technicians, and we should be up to full complement plus 458, as I said, staff, which is already having a significant improvement in our response times. We've also aligned all our shift patterns to most closely match demand as best as we possibly can, whilst maintaining good practice, such as reviewing with the Health and Safety Executive our fatigue management for our staff to try to improve their health and well-being along with those new shifts. The single biggest challenge now remains those hospital turnaround times. So whilst we've put additional resource in, the extra time that our staff are spending at hospitals depleting some of that additionality, which is meaning that for some patients they continue to wait far too long. For those red patients, such as you mentioned, that dreadful response time, those tend to be patients who have started off on a lower acuity, and because our clinical advisors are becoming concerned that patient might be deteriorating, they would upgrade the call to get a quicker response to them. So we are working very closely with our supplier of our command and control system to be able to record those two times separately so that we can see the differences in times from those patients that are yellow and are upgraded and those patients that start off in a red or a purple higher acuity category.
That certainly sounds like a promising process improvement, and hopefully it will yield significant results. It sounds promising from what you're saying. And you did mention, of course, that one of the key sticking points, if you like, is that interface with the emergency departments at acute hospitals. And we had heard last week of a pilot being trialled in some health boards to ease demand on emergency departments, where ambulance crews phone ahead to speak to an emergency medicine consultant, make a decision on whether it's best for the patient to be presented to the A&E department or to a different facility. Do you have an insight on that particular system that's being trialled, and could it be scaled up to ease demand on emergency departments on a national scale?
Yeah, so I think you're talking about flow navigation, yeah. That most health systems across Scotland have got in one form or other. They've been trying them out in different ways across the country. Perhaps one of the most successful is in the NHS Grampian area, where 70% of those yellow patients, the lower acuity patients, our staff will phone the flow navigation centre before they convey the patient to seek further senior clinical support and take a decision with and for the patient and with the senior clinician in the flow navigation centre to reach an outcome that all decide is best for that patient at that particular point in time. So that might be, for example, to in-hours or out-of-hours GP services. It might be directly into mental health pathways. It might be into a falls and frailty pathway, for example. So we're working with all boards in terms of developing the flow navigation centres. We've developed a criteria of what good looks like from an ambulance perspective in terms of being able to get quick access, because obviously our staff are in emergency situations and they want to be confident that they can get a response as quickly as possible, preferably 24/7 access for when patients need them, particularly elderly patients who fall tend to be out of hours, and so we need support in terms of those clinical decisions out of hours, and a whole range of different pathways that we've been developing with services across the country, such as respiratory, community respiratory services too. So that's now been shared across all NHS boards, and we're working with them to implement that as much as possible before this winter.
You mentioned that flow navigation is implemented in one form or another across all territorial boards, and you're in a fairly unique position where you kind of sit across all of those boards and have that perspective. How dynamic and adaptive are the territorial boards to sharing best practice, and are you able to help indicate where things are doing well things are doing well elsewhere that could be adapted, you know, across the nation as a whole and bring everyone up to a higher performance level?
Yes, we're part of the Urgent and Unscheduled Care Collaborative across all boards. Scottish Ambulance Service, NHS24, Healthcare Improvement Scotland are all involved in that. And that's very much about learning together, sharing good practice and understanding what works in one system and whether it can be applied in another system. You'll be aware that part of the challenge in terms of implementing exactly the same in other systems as demographics, workforce availability, and geographical issues.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. And Sandish Gohan.
Thank you. So when you spoke earlier about how there's a difference between being categorised highly and then being upgraded, the concern is that somebody's waited so long, their condition has deteriorated, thus requiring that upgrade. So do you recognise that actually, even though they have waited at yellow, they've now become red, and that is now a red category waiting time, so it's not a separate thing?
It's the way that I mentioned in terms of categorising it was as more mainly for us to understand that upgrade or downgrade. There would be no process change whatsoever from the patient experience perspective. What we have done to try to improve our safety netting of those calls is last winter we introduced what we call the Integrated Clinical Hub. And this is staffed by GPs, by advanced paramedic and nurse practitioners, and by paramedics, so that for those non-immediately life-threatening calls, they can safety net those patients, so they can look to see how long they've been waiting. They can provide callbacks to those patients and work out the best pathway for those patients at a particular point in time. And our senior clinical decision makers help us provide
that
underpinning safety net.
Is that tied into NHS 24 or is that separate?
So this is separate from NHS 24. So this will handle both 999 calls that are sitting waiting on an ambulance response that are not immediately life-threatening. But also if we get calls from healthcare professions who potentially are much lower acuity and might have been waiting too long, they will safety net those calls and try to find the best pathway for those calls. They're able also to identify that many calls that come through healthcare professionals and indeed from 999 callers, similar to the flow navigation centres, don't require an emergency ambulance at that particular point in time. Often different pathways are better for them, such as respiratory pathways, mental health pathways, falls and
absolutely,
safety.
There are different options. But one of the issues as a GP is when I ask for an ambulance and I give a fair reflection, so I feel that it's a four-hour ambulance, invariably a lot of us have to think, well, that actually means an eight-hour ambulance. So maybe we upgrade that to a two-hour or one-hour, because if we don't, this patient is not going to be getting in. So how could you reassure professionals that are calling you to say, we need an ambulance for this patient, and this is the realistic timescale, that you can actually meet the timescale that the GPs or the other professionals that call you say?
Yeah, so our demand and capacity programme built in some of those parameters. We've also been investing in what we call low acuity CARD 46 resources. So those are for GP and other healthcare referrals that are not time critical. We will understand what the acuity and the intervention levels are en route for those patients, and if possible, they can be served by our ambulance technicians and ambulance care assistants. And we've invested in CARD 46 resources, which is part of the cost pressures that I mentioned earlier on, so that we can provide a quicker response. We're not where we want to be yet for those healthcare professional calls, but certainly that's our plan, to further develop our CARD 46 resource tier so that we can service our healthcare professional calls much more quickly than at present. But it has been improving, and we continue to remain committed to making further improvements.
Thank you.
I'm now going to move to Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Pauline. I want to ask about the response time definition change. Now, I understand that for all UK ambulance services, this changed on the 1st of April 2022. Now, what does this change mean for staff, and what does it mean for patients?
So the response time definition change was in response to significant extensive consultation that we had carried out with the public and our staff, who were concerned that our sole focus was on response time and we needed to broaden our horizon to focus on clinical outcomes and patient experience as well. So as well as looking at response time now, and rather than looking at an average response time within 8 minutes, for example, for our immediately life-threatening calls, we monitor both our median response time and our 95th percentile, so that we're looking at those patients at the tail that might be waiting too long. So it enables us, by looking at both those measures, it enables us to identify where there's the opportunities for improvement and to target our improvement activity much more effectively than before. Our clinical outcome measures, we've been working with organisations, international organisations, to make sure that we can compare and benchmark our performance with others. So, for example, our out-of-hospital cardiac arrest performance standards are all internationally recognised performance standards, and we continue to work to improve our survival from cardiac arrest. You'll be aware that we've also introduced the major trauma services across Scotland now. So again, we measure our performance against internationally recognised standards, likewise for stroke too. So it's a much broader, more extensive measurement framework that staff recognise, that our patients feel is much more meaningful for them, but still maintaining that focus on response times. And the immediately life-threatening calls, we have our purple calls, our most acutely, seriously unwell patients who are time-critical and at risk of deterioration. The median response time now for them at target is 6 minutes rather than the 8 minutes that it was before. And for our red, our seriously ill patients, the median response target is 7 minutes for them.
And do you feel that there still needs to be more education for the public in terms of when they phone you, you know, do we need to keep putting that message out? I know work has been done in the past, but do we need to keep doing that to make sure they're going to the right place and getting the right help at the right time?
Yeah, we work very closely with colleagues across Scotland, NHS Scotland and Scottish Government in terms of right place, right care, right time messages to try to inform people about the best service for them at that particular point in time. And I think we need to continue to do that, particularly as we change services and adapt changes to make the population change in health needs.
Thank you. I'm going to move to Carol Malkin.
Thank you. I'm interested in the response times that you were talking about, and the sort of newer model that you have around that, and about just the confidence the public should have in that. Have you undertaken any evaluation of how these responses, you know, are working for patients and their families?
So we're constantly evaluating our practice. I mentioned some of those clinical measures in terms of a clinical outcome. We've got the best ever clinical outcome for our purple categories, 56% survival rates, which is really superb, but we're never complacent in terms of the opportunities to do more for those most seriously unwell patients. We do a range of activities working with patient focus groups, public involvement groups. We also are members of Care Opinion, so we welcome feedback, good and less good. We view all feedback as a learning opportunity. And we take on board that feedback. We've got comprehensive systems of governance to make sure that for all the learning that we gather, whether it's from adverse events, whether it's from thank you notes, Care Opinion, that we take that on board and we build that into our improvement plan.
Thank you. I mean, I think, as I'm sure you well know, the public hugely value the service, yeah. But there are definite problems in the system, particularly around, you know, ambulances being available for people. So in terms of things that you could recommend that the committee could, you know, ask for or speak to the Scottish Government about, what would be key in that for you in terms of the delays that people can have, particularly around life-threatening situations?
Well, we try to absolutely minimise those life-threatening delays through the safety netting that I spoke about, and we are getting quicker all the time. So May's performance was much better than April's, and we continue to really focus on getting those additional staff into place at the right time and making sure that our staff are appropriately trained and developed. As I said before, the single biggest issue is the turnaround challenge, and it is complex. It's a reflection of the wider capacity challenges, not just in the EDs and in hospitals, but across health and social care and delayed discharges too. And we're working really closely with health boards and the Scottish Government and IJBs around how we can create capacity too. One of our successes over the last few years has been that ability to recruit and retain staff. We still remain a very attractive employer, and the BSc Paramedic Science undergraduate programme is well oversubscribed. It's one of the most oversubscribed courses in Scottish universities. So we are working to see whether there's other ways that we can help people into careers, not just within the Scottish Ambulance Service, but paramedics and ambulance technicians are highly qualified members of staff that we can use in different areas of service provision. So, for example, we've got paramedics and advanced paramedics working in GP out of our services and in our services doing home visits on behalf of GPs. We've got some staff working at front door of accident and emergency departments to help out in terms of staffing. And we're working with boards to understand what the potential is there to perhaps help in terms of some of their workforce challenges.
Thank you.
We'll come to Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. On the clinical response model, I know a public engagement exercise was undertaken into the new clinical response model, which found that over 90% of the public supported it. That is encouraging, but what assessment has been made of the public's ongoing awareness of the new clinical response model?
So it's been in place now for several years, since 2017. So it is the clinical response model. And as I mentioned to the other committee member, we constantly are looking for feedback from patients and from staff and from other stakeholders. And we take on board that feedback. So, for example, one of the evaluations that we did a couple of years ago, we noticed that patients with breathing difficulties had a higher cardiac arrest rate than we initially thought, so we upgraded that category into a purple response category that were previously in red to help improve outcomes for those patients. I mentioned falls and frailty services. We've been doing a lot of work in terms of accessibility of falls pathways and being able to make direct referrals from people's homes into rapid assessment teams from fall services and for follow-up care for those services. And we often find when we get into people's home, particularly more elderly members of our population, that they often don't want to go to hospital. They really look for us to help find alternative pathways for them so that they can maintain their independence at home.
Obviously, at times when people phone the ambulance service, yeah, they're in acute distress or in acute need of help. Is there ongoing assessment of how those calls are handled, the experience of call handlers as well, and how those response times and categorisations are communicated to people who are waiting?
Yes, so we constantly review the call handling scripts that we call them. You'll understand that there's really strict governance around those strict scripts, and there's an international academy that we feed in our experience, both in terms of our data and the experience of our staff and the experience of our patients, so that we can constantly refine those scripts and make sure that they are current best practice based on what we know and any research findings that we've been able to develop internally with Scottish universities, or indeed learn from international practice.
That's great. And to what extent is the Scottish Ambulance Service confident that the public are supportive of the new triage system in particular?
I think, as your colleague said, the public highly, highly value the ambulance service here in Scotland. We don't get many complaints at all about our response to our immediately life-threatening patients. As I said earlier, there is more that we want to do and more that we need to do for those patients that have been waiting too long, that are in the lower acuity categories. And that's where our focus is. How can we get response times improved for those patients? And the key enabler to that now is getting our ambulance crews turned around quicker at the front door of departments, so that we can get back out responding to those patients, as well as doing the work in our integrated clinical hub to identify alternatives for patients at the point of call, and from the scene through the flow navigation support to try again to identify alternatives, so that for those patients that don't want or need to go to hospital, there are alternatives that can help them in terms of getting into the right pathway of care for them at the presenting condition.
That's great. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. And Emma Harper has a supplementary on this issue.
Yep, thanks, Convener. Good morning.
Good morning.
To Pauline. You mentioned falls earlier, and I'm just looking at the 2030 document that said 12% of ambulance call-outs are for somebody who has fallen, so there's work being done to look at that. But 10% is also for patients with respiratory difficulties, like COPD, exacerbation. And as a lung health cross-party group co-convener, I'm interested in what work is being done to help support the respiratory patients, for instance, because they might not necessarily need an admission, they might need a referral to an onward pathway for better management of their COPD.
Indeed. So falls, respiratory and mental health pathways are our top three pathways that we're working with boards and IJBs to try to get direct referral and accessibility of our staff to direct refer, or indeed to seek support and advice from those specialists. So respiratory patients often are known to respiratory specialists and are part of community respiratory nursing teams, but many of them might not be or might not have accessed that service before. And what we've found through a whole series of different work streams is that we are often in contact with patients that might not be users of those specialist services, so that we can connect them in and help them in terms of getting a more effective treatment pathway in place. We don't have widespread coverage of respiratory pathways, but it's something that we're working with each system to try again to encourage the adoption of good practice and to have those respiratory pathways available for our staff at the times when patients present with those, which is often out with 9 to 5.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We're going to move on to our next theme, and I'll pass to Sue Weber.
Thank you, Convener.
You'll know that the NHS target for to reduce sickness absences is to less than 5%, but in the submission, I think it's in the ambulance service is 8.9%, and that you've got a high proportion of staff with mental or physical health problems compared to other sections as well. So what is your current sickness absence rate if the COVID-related absences are removed? And what are the main underlying causes of those non-COVID absences? And is it still the musculoskeletal and the physical pain aspects as well?
Yes, yeah, so for May last year, May 23, sorry, our sickness absence rate was 7.6%, and typically the COVID element of that is between 0.5 and 1% within the Scottish Ambulance Service. Staff health and wellbeing is one of our top organisational priorities. And since I was last here at the committee, we have launched our integrated staff health and wellbeing strategy, which is about focusing on healthy body, healthy mind, healthy lifestyle, healthy culture and healthy environment for our staff. It was co-designed with our staff, and we also looked for international best practice as well as working with the other emergency services, other UK ambulance services and indeed other public services, including health boards here in Scotland. So it's a comprehensive strategy to support staff to be well at work and when they become unwell, to help them in terms of returning to work as quickly as possible. Through that strategy, we've invested in additional specialist staff. So we've got additional health and wellbeing specialist staff and organisational development staff who have got a very detailed action plan that they are progressing with some vigour. And those actions include things like TRIM management. So this is where people in our service, for example, who have higher exposure perhaps to traumatic events than other healthcare professionals because of the nature of the work that they do, can get support by peers. So we have recently trained 60 ambulance staff in TRIM practitioner training who will support the rest of the organisation. Hugely oversubscribed. We asked for 60 volunteers. We had 250 volunteers come forward to support staff. And this was work that we had done just pre-COVID. We tested out TRIM training and TRIM practice within our service in a couple of locations. And it was very successfully received. So that's now been rolled out. We've got peer supporters in place across our whole organisation as well, so that people who just want to chat can chat. We've also got financial wellbeing support for staff. We've got links to citizen advice and other services because often we find that issues that affect the mental wellbeing of our staff are not just work-related issues but wider societal issues as well. The top reasons remain, apart from COVID, anxiety, stress, depression, back problems and musculoskeletal problems. And when we were developing our strategy, it was apparent that ambulance services worldwide do suffer higher rates of sickness absence than other parts of the health and social care system. And part of that is because of the psychological risks that they face. Part of it is the physicality of the work that they do, and part of that is the exposure to traumatic events, and often not individual events but repeated exposure to, which is why we're putting so much emphasis on healthy mind activities. We've also got a series of staff organised events such as West Lothian Breakfast Club, which is a drop-in club, not just for our staff, it's been extended to the other emergency services and parts of the NHS in West Lothian, which is a social event but when people can just come together. We've got walking clubs in place. We've got discounted gym membership for staff across most local authority areas too. As part of the demand capacity programme that I mentioned earlier on, that's taken a bit of the pressure off of staff. When we ask staff what matters to them, They tell us that management of demand is one of the biggest stressors on their time at work. So having additional resources to help manage the demand, having those resources on at the right time in the right place is helping. And again, if we can get that turnaround issue dealt with, that'll help more people get finished their shift on time and get back to their families and be fresher for the next shift.
That does preclude my second question, because there was so much in the answer. But could I ask briefly, in terms of the evaluation of all of those systems that you or things that you're putting in place, have you got something to assess how they're working and what impact they're going to have?
Yes, yeah, so as part of our health and wellbeing strategy, we've developed evaluation models and performance data. Some of it is hard information, such as the sickness absence rate, the length of absence, the type of absence, and some of it is about more surveys, such as what matters to staff, the iMatter survey, different staff engagement events. Do a lot of station walkabouts, an online weekly event with staff where they can ask anything, and we theme up those issues. So, for example, 2 weeks ago we did a culture week within the service where we had various external speakers about culture and environment across the service too. So there's a range of different measurements that we use to evaluate the effectiveness of our health and wellbeing strategy.
Thank you.
And I think that ties in well with the questions that Sandesh Gohani has for you.
Absolutely. Thank you. And that was a very full answer that you gave to Sue Webber. So my first question is, in the last 12 months, what is the attrition rate of your advanced paramedics?
Paramedics is higher than our base workforce. I believe it's over 12%. I've not got the figure to my head at the moment, but I can come back to
roughly,
you.
Roughly around that. Okay. Yeah. And so for all the things that you're doing, I've been contacted by paramedics. Mm-hmm. And one paramedic said to me that they suffered from numerous traumatic situations and suffered PTSD. So they wanted to go into the triaging area because they just wanted to be away from that frontline environment. But this paramedic was forced to quit because she was told that she had to go to the frontline and she had to be in ambulances. And I'm also being contacted by paramedics who are saying that they absolutely do not like, these advanced paramedics, they don't like the fact that they're only triaging. They're not getting out. So what would you say to those paramedics?
So I obviously don't know the specifics of the first case that you mentioned. If you want to contact me after, I'd be happy to try to understand the particular circumstances. There are a range of different opportunities now for paramedics that have never been there before, not just in terms of the clinical triage arrangements, but also in terms of education, professional development. I mentioned the BSc Paramedic Science course that is now available too. So we continue to develop different opportunities for our staff. In terms of the advanced practitioners, there is a 30% opportunity. So 30% of their time will be spent in terms of remote triage, 30% typically working with GP in or out of our services, and 30% supporting immediate response to patients through the 999 system or through the healthcare professionals system. And we continue to work with those advanced practitioners in terms of that role development. This is a really new role and it was introduced really quickly at the very beginning of the pandemic in terms of being able to safely respond to patients and identify those patients who required an immediate ambulance response. And we've continued to refine it over the time since we introduced this model in April 2020. And the feedback from those practitioners has been essential to that. So they are highly valued members of staff across the whole health and social care environment, as I'm sure you're aware.
What if advanced paramedic came to you and said, look, I don't like this 30-30-30. I want to be out there more. I want to be going and seeing patients more. What would you have flexibility for them?
So the arrangement that we've got in place at the moment is that 30-30-30 split that I spoke about. But as I said, we're continuing to refine that model. And we find that some staff prefer to do the remote triage than in terms of response to... This is very much work in progress. This is very much a work in progress, working with that team and continuing to evolve the model so that we can get the best out of people. But as you know, these are very, very experienced and highly qualified staff. And we've shown and proven that the work that they do in remote triage is very effective. And the feedback from patients is very, very high.
So if you have paramedics that enjoy the triaging and you have paramedics that don't enjoy the triaging, surely it would make sense to allow them to do the bits that they really enjoy.
So in an ideal world, however, we need to make sure that we've got enough people doing the triaging and we've got enough people in terms of that response. And that's the work that I mentioned that's in progress at the moment. We're modelling out the numbers that we need to do both and are trying to make sure that we've got the right people with the right skills in those places that can support colleagues and support patients going forward.
Okay, and finally... when you do your exit interviews for your, especially advanced paramedics that are leaving the service, what is the reason given that they're leaving the service?
I don't know off the top of my head. I can tell you in terms of anecdote, though, that some of them tell me that there are other opportunities in other parts of the health service. And often part of that is about pay. In other parts of GP practice, for example, who directly employ our advanced practitioners, and other parts of it are about the opportunities in different parts, whether it's out of our services or in our services. But I can certainly get that information to you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm now going to move on to Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you very much, Convener. We've heard about a lot of fantastic work that's going on locally and nationally. I thought my microphone was off there. For example, the introduction of the Hospital Ambulance Liaison Officers, very aptly, HALO being the acronym for that. And also Consultant Connect is something that's really interesting too, that direct contact between the ambulance service and senior clinicians that allows remote decisions to be made in minutes and saves going through A&E, preventing those waits there. I'm wondering as well, I heard recently at the Lanarkshire Local Police Plan, where it's what about 10% of the demand for police forces in Scotland is, that mental health was becoming really significant and that, you know, it really wasn't sustainable at this point in time. And I'm just wondering what kind of work is going on with Police Scotland to create those kind of direct links there as well, to give them the support to reduce the amount of time that police spend in A&E. So, for example, on one evening they had all five cars were actually at A&E too. So just really interested in any pilots, any work that's going forward to improve things and the impact that that's making. Thanks.
Yes, we work really closely with the Police Scotland and also the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, and mental health is one of our top priorities amongst all three services. You'll probably have heard from Jim Miller earlier today about the work that we do with NHS 24 and Police Scotland in terms of the mental health triage hub that is hosted by NHS 24. So both Scottish Ambulance Service staff and control room staff and Police Scotland staff can refer for those people in distress into the mental health triage hub that's hosted by NHS 24. We also have, in February this year, introduced a service where police officers can call ambulance control direct from scene and they can get support in terms of decision-making, clinical decision-making around those people that they are worried about at scene. And what we've found is the majority of those calls are in that yellow category, over 46% of the calls from police officers at scene, and about 40% of those patients we don't convey to hospital. So we're trying to work with Police Scotland to understand what exactly are those patients' needs and how can we develop alternative pathways that are more appropriate to their needs at that particular point in time. The feedback so far from Police Scotland has been very, very positive. They get a four-second average pickup time for their calls. So it's very reassuring for those police officers at scene that they're able to contact a healthcare professional and get that advice for them. And also that if it is more serious, for example, a red call, or perhaps a road traffic collision or a stabbing or a seizure, that we can get our support to them as quickly as possible. And whilst the ambulance is on the way, then we provide clinical decision support by radio to the police officers on scene.
Fantastic, thank you.
Thank you. I'm now going to move to Emma Harper.
Thank you, thank you. So in the last session of Parliament, I was a health committee member and we heard from the ambulance service about how the police ended up looking after people in the emergency room and taking up their time, for instance. And I would be interested to know what work has been done to support, you know, the police dealing with the NHS calls or ambulance, whether it's the ambulance or the other NHS could do that.
So I mentioned the work in terms of police officers being able to contact us directly from scene, and 40% of those yellow patients not requiring conveyance to emergency departments. So again, very much working with Police Scotland to understand what is the best pathway for that person at that particular point in time. I think last time I was here, I might have mentioned the mental health triage car, which at that time we were staffing with a paramedic police officer and a mental health nurse. We've learned from that, taken on board the feedback, and now we've got three mental health cards in Scotland, one in Glasgow, one in Dundee and one in Inverness, that are staffed solely by a mental health nurse and a paramedic, and where we require police assistance then we'll then call, so that saves police officer time there as well. We're doing specific work with both Police Scotland officers and our staff around suicide prevention and support for people that may be contemplating suicide, and providing other joint training opportunities for both police officers and paramedic and ambulance staff as well. So we're constantly looking for ways where we can support each other in terms of dealing with more vulnerable people that might be in mental health crisis as well. We've got a team now within the Scottish Ambulance Service, our high intensity users team, for those people that are regular callers to us, and we often find that many of these callers have underlying mental health conditions that we can connect with other parts of the system and make sure that there's appropriate support arrangements in place. Drug harm reduction is another area that we work very closely with Police Scotland on. We've both now got all our staff trained and have kits in terms of take-home naloxone programme. We've handed out over 2,600 kits to members of family or friends of those people who have contacted us with a drug overdose to try to support people that might overdose in the future too. And we're also working to see what more we can do around community safety initiatives and connecting those people that might have overdosed into rehab services and treatment services. We found that 40% of people that we were attending were not currently in treatment services, so we've been able to make contact on behalf of those patients with their permission into treatment services and support them and hopefully stop that cycle of repeated overdose.
And also, I'm thinking in liaising not just with the police but the fire service as well. That I'm sure that is a part of work that's ongoing. And I'm also interested in part of the work that we do to engage with people who have a harmful use of drugs and alcohol is like reducing the stigma. So it's tackling stigma or addressing stigma and the language we use. Is that part of continuing professional development that would be provided for ambulance service staff?
Absolutely. We got additional funding from Scottish Government in terms of employing specialist mental health teams within the Scottish Ambulance Service who've been embarking on a wholesale education and development programme for all our staff. So, for example, a couple of weeks ago, they were in our ambulance control centre supporting our call handling staff in terms of mental health patients, and some of the issues they've been dealing with is around stigma and language too. But the training and education programme is for all staff within our service.
And do you monitor which persons that have like a mental health like emergency or an urgent need that the police might be engaging with them instead of the ambulance service? Is that something that we track when the police escort somebody to the emergency room, for instance, or the emergency department, rather than the ambulance crew?
So we don't specifically track that, but the police obviously track that. And that's some of the work that we're trying to do with Police Scotland, the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, and with Public Health Scotland, who we share all our data with and can work to kind of interpret and analyse the data on our behalf. We obviously need to make sure that we respect confidentiality issues in terms of that data sharing. But that's work that we've got as part of our work programme with Scottish Fire and Rescue Service and Police Scotland. We've got a comprehensive collaboration programme with work streams around knowledge and intelligence sharing, and what's the data telling us in terms of users of our service and where we can identify different opportunities that we can be more proactive and preventative in our approach across the three emergency services rather than constantly responding perhaps to the same people and trying to get them into more appropriate pathways that can help treat and manage them with and for them in the future.
Mm-hmm. Can I have a final question about...
I've got a few want to come in, so if it's very brief.
I will wait and bring it up later because I think it'll be worth a letter. It's just about maternity services and delivering babies in ambulances in rural areas, for instance, and I can pick it up later.
Thank you. Can I declare an interest as an RMN with current NMC registration? I'm just wondering if there's been any assessment made of the impact of the mental health assessment units being established across the country in terms of ambulance waiting times at A&E?
I don't have that information to hand, convener, but I can certainly get that information. As I said, it's one of our top pathways that we're trying to develop in terms of direct access to mental health assessment units for patients that present through the 999 system.
Thank you. I'd be really grateful if you could do it. Paul, come to Paul Sweeney.
Yeah, thanks, convener. Just wanted to pick up, it's a frequent issue that's raised by police officers about the amount of their time that's spent dealing with cases where they don't feel qualified or capable of actually addressing the situation. And the number of calls made to Police Scotland citing a situation of mental health crisis or suicide risk has increased by almost 10,000 from 14,540 in 2018 to 23,406 in 2022. You mentioned this pilot, if you like, of triage cars. There's three of which operating in Scotland at the moment. Do you feel there's an opportunity to actually look at a business case to expand that model if it is a more effective and probably cost-effective solution, given the huge costs currently incurred by response policing attending incidents or cases where it might well be a known person who's got a history of calling the police in relation to these issues, or the fact that they aren't qualified to deal with it when they do arrive at the scene?
It may be that is the most appropriate response. The work that we're doing with Police Scotland at the moment, though, is trying to get behind that data to understand what those people are needing at that particular point in time that Police Scotland are responding to them, and to try to develop alternatives that are much more appropriate and are serviced by the most appropriate service or agency for that person at that particular point in time. So I mentioned earlier the direct referral from police officers on scene now. So we're getting about 1,300 referrals each month from Police Scotland officers from scene, as well as the substantial referrals that we get direct from police control too. So it's very much work in progress, trying to understand what the needs of people are and trying to work with Police Scotland and other agencies to put in place more effective services for those people.
Okay. Thanks. That was all. Thank you.
Thank you. And Stephanie Callaghan wanted to come back in on one of the issues that I think she raised earlier.
Thanks for allowing me to come back in, Convener. It's just kind of going back a wee bit to something that Emma said, and I can't really remember all the specifics around this. I'm not sure if it's something that you'll be able to answer or not, but certainly in conversations, I know that the Lanarkshire Drugs Death Prevention Group had raised some issues around information sharing, which you kind of touched on before there, and said there was real fear around GDPR. And one of the big things that they were concerned about was the fact that they couldn't get non-fatal overdose information, because of course usually those who've died who die have tried before. So I'm just wondering if that's something that you're able to comment on, if there's issues around that, if it's something that's been tackled just now.
Yeah, so often there are challenges in terms of GDPR regulations, but we very much try to work with other agencies to understand why we are asked to share data and to understand what the potential harm avoidance is in terms of being able to share that data. So very much we look for opportunities to share data where it's going to prevent harm and lead to service development in future. I'm not specifically aware of the work going on with the Lanarkshire Alcohol and Drugs Partnership, but again, happy to pick up with you out with committee if there's particular challenges.
That's really helpful, thanks.
Thank you. Can I thank Pauline Howie for her attendance at committee today, and please feel free to leave. We're going to move on with our meeting. The next item on our agenda is consideration of two negative instruments. The first instrument is Food Scotland Act 2015, Compliance Notices Regulations 2023. The purpose of the instrument is to list offences in relation to which compliance notices are set out in the Food Scotland Act 2015 may be used as an alternative to criminal proceedings. The relevant offences relate to food information, food composition standards, novel foods, foods for specific groups and food contact materials. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered the instrument at its meeting on the 13th of June 2023 and has drawn the Parliament's attention to a cross-referencing error in the paragraph 33 of the schedule should refer to Regulation 4 of the Novel Foods Scotland Regulations 2017 instead of Regulation 6, brackets 2. The committee noted that the Scottish Government intends to correct this error at the earliest opportunity. No motion to annul has been received in relation to this instrument. Do members have any comments? Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. I just have a comment because of my interest in like food standards and how we are altering and changing and engaging in things like novel foods. I'm interested in the very last paragraph, number 9. It talks about monitoring. And it says Food Standards Scotland will work with local authorities where problems or suspected infringements of the legislation arise. So I'm interested to know, and it might be that we write to Food Standards Scotland, how will Food Standards work with local authorities? How will we monitor that just in terms of, for general interest, really?
Is the committee content to write on that basis? Thank you. Can I confirm agreement with the negative instrument? Thank you very much. The second instrument is National Health Services Changes to Overseas Visitors, Scotland Amendment Regulations 2023. The purpose of this instrument is to ensure overseas visitors from certain British overseas territories will not be charged for certain treatment provided by health boards in Scotland in accordance with healthcare agreements. The instrument inserts a further 5 territories: Ascension Island, Bermuda, Cayman Islands, Pitcairn, Henderson, Doucet and Oino Islands, and Tristan da Cunha into Schedule 2 of the NHS or National Health Service Charges to Overseas Visitors Scotland Regulations 1989. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered the instrument at its meeting on the 13th of June 2023 and made no recommendations. No motion to annul has been received in relation to this instrument. Do members have any comments? No? Okay. I propose that the instrument does not make any recommendations, and the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to the negative instrument. Does any member disagree with this? Thank you very much. Our next meeting will be a session with the Cabinet Secretary for NHS Recovery, Health and Social Care, based on the evidence that we have gathered in our recent scrutiny of frontline NHS boards. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today.